You're listening to the Books Track Audiobooks, the channel that brings you to grow up your mind. Myself H.T. Sony. And today we will listening The Hidden Brain by Shankar Vedantam. Chapter 9, Disarming the Bomb, Politics, Race, and the Hidden Brain. In 1994, the psychologist Anthony Greenwald at the University of Washington was exploring links between unconscious mental associations and attitudes. I've talked about such associations before. Our hidden brain notices discrete things that regularly appear together and associates them. Every time we see one thing, it prompts us to expect the other, too. We associate insects with stings and annoyance, rattlesnakes with bites and danger, and a garbage dump with disgust. There is nothing mysterious about this. Over the course of our lives, we have seen innumerable links between insects and stings, snakes and danger, and garbage and rot. Greenwald guessed that if he gave people a word, they would be faster matching concepts that were associated with that word than concepts that were not associated. It should be easier to bring America to mind when someone said baseball than when someone said badminton. Greenwald designed a word association game. He put the names of a number of flowers in a list with the names of various insects, and then threw in a number of positive and negative words such as beauty, love, nasty, and ugly. Unsurprisingly, he found it very easy to group roses and tulips with beauty and love, and cockroach and beetle with nasty and ugly. When he put all the words in a single list and timed himself as he put a check mark next to all the flowers and the positive words, he completed the task a little faster than when he tried to check off all the flowers and the negative words. Every time his hidden brain heard rose or tulip, it automatically provided him with the positive associations that people usually have with flowers. When he encountered beauty and love, he checked them off quickly. When he encountered nasty and ugly, his conscious mind had to connect the unrelated concepts and resist the hidden brain's answers. Predictably, this took longer. So far, the test had not told Greenwald anything he didn't know. Who needs a test to find out he or she associates flowers with beauty? But Greenwald did not stop there. He replaced the names of the flowers and insects in his list with typically Caucasian names such as Adam and Chip and typically African American names such as Alonzo and Jamal, and then tossed in a bunch of pleasant and unpleasant words. He tried to play the same association game. Since he didn't consciously associate either Caucasian or African American names with positive or negative concepts, he assumed he would associate all the names with pleasant and unpleasant words at the same speed. He was wrong. He found it was as difficult to associate white names with unpleasant words as it was to associate flowers with unpleasant words. But Greenwald's hidden brain effortlessly associated black names with words such as evil and poison. It was as if his hidden brain equated white names with positive concepts and black names with negative concepts. Greenwald was horrified. He didn't think of himself as a racist, and he didn't know what to make of his performance. He got in touch with a colleague, the psychologist Mahzarin Banaji. Without telling her what the test was about, he asked her to play the word association game on her computer. Banaji found she had results identical to Greenwald's. She effortlessly associated white names with positive concepts and black names with negative concepts. That's ridiculous, she thought. She knew she was no racist. She was a professor who spent lots of time teaching other people how to watch out for prejudice. Since Greenwald's test required Banaji to tap computer keys with her left or right index finger, Banaji figured the weird results had to do with whether someone was right-handed or left-handed, so she reorganized the test on her computer. All of a sudden, it was now her other hand that effortlessly grouped black names with negative words and white names with positive words. Banaji changed the order in which the names were presented. It made no difference. Her hidden brain simply found it easier to associate Alonzo and Jamal with evil and poison, and Adam and Chip with dream and heaven. Banaji sat back in her chair and stared. She felt small in a way she had never felt before. This is the origin of a psychological test for unconscious bias that has revolutionized the scientific study of prejudice in the last decade. Greenwald dubbed it the Implicit Association Test, or IAT. Millions of people have taken the free internet tests that he and Banaji have made available over the internet, at www.implicit.harvard.edu. If you take what is known as the race bias test today, you'll see white and black faces instead of names, since this provides more accurate results. Hundreds of thousands of people have been disconcerted by their scores. Large majorities of Americans, including substantial numbers of African Americans, find it easier to associate white faces rather than black faces with positive concepts. Overwhelming majorities find it easier to associate men's names rather than women's names with careers and professional activity. The tests detect things that seem absurd. Many Americans are quicker to associate the British actors Hugh Grant and Elizabeth Hurley with being American than the tennis player Michael Chung and the television personality Connie Chung. It is as though their unconscious minds associate whites, even whites who are foreigners, as American, and Americans who are people of color as foreigners. In one set of tests before the 2008 presidential election, psychologists found that many voters unconsciously associated former British Prime Minister Tony Blair with being more American than Barack Obama. If you'd asked volunteers which one, Blair or Obama, was American, of course, they would have looked at you funny. If people knew, at a conscious level, that Obama was American and Blair was foreign, why did their unconscious minds have the opposite associations? With every variation of the test, volunteers responded exactly as Greenwald and Banaji had to that first test, with disbelief. If the only thing the implicit association test did was to make people feel bad about the unpleasant associations in their heads, the test would not be very useful. Ultimately, we're interested in people's behavior, not in thought crimes. But over the past decade, many experiments have shown that results on the implicit association test predict people's behavior in real-world settings. In tests conducted before the 2008 presidential election, for example, the speed at which people unconsciously associated Obama with being American predicted whether they supported the biracial candidate in both the Democratic primary and the general election. People who unconsciously saw Obama as less American than Hillary Clinton and John McCain were less likely to vote for him. This was so even if, when explicitly asked, they stated Obama was every bit as American as his competitors. It is useful to situate all conversations about race in their proper context. Voting against Obama did not automatically make anyone a racist. And race bias was just one factor in how people thought about politics. Race bias in the 2008 presidential election may have pulled the country a few percentage points in one direction. The bias would not have made a difference to the way most people voted, but it could have tipped people on the edge one way rather than the other. The bias affected both Republicans and Democrats. At an unconscious level, not seeing Obama as American exerted a subtle tug on people. It made them less likely to want to see him elected president. Remember, we are not talking about people who consciously thought of Obama as a foreigner with a doctored birth certificate. We're talking about people who never would have said aloud, or even to themselves, that they disliked Obama because he was foreign. But when they thought about the candidates, Obama may have just felt a little different. Hillary Clinton, John McCain, and Sarah Palin may have felt a little more like one of us. Once people felt that way, they could easily have come up with reasons to support their intuitions. You can always find things about a candidate to like or dislike. How do we know that unconscious attitudes about Obama preceded the conscious justification of those attitudes? In the experiment, it was people's unconscious attitudes, as revealed by Greenwald's test, rather than their conscious views about the issues, that better predicted whether they voted for Obama or preferred another candidate. The idea that we provide ourselves with explanations to justify our conclusions is counterintuitive because it certainly feels as though our conclusions are the product of careful thought. Here is an analogy that might help. This is not an original idea of mine. Let's say you kick a soccer ball into the air. Imagine that as it flies, the ball suddenly acquires consciousness. How would it explain to itself why it is flying? It has no knowledge or awareness of having been kicked. But since it knows that all effects have causes, it tells itself that it is a ball that decided to fly, because that's the most plausible explanation. In the same way, once the hidden brain whispered to these voters that Obama was different, they quickly came up with plausible ways to explain to themselves why they didn't like the candidate, his views on healthcare, perhaps, or the economy. These results are upsetting and embarrassing. We know we are decades away from Selma and Birmingham, from those bad old days when women were not allowed to vote. We've changed, haven't we? Banaji once told me that the embarrassment she and others felt after doing the implicit association test was a good thing. It showed that people not only believed they were not biased, but that they did not want to be biased. Banaji, Greenwald, and another psychologist named Brian Nosek at the University of Virginia have studied the results of hundreds of thousands of volunteers who have taken the implicit association test on the internet. The psychologists have created a map of America that shows the peaks and valleys of bias, the places where unconscious racial prejudice is highest and where it is lowest. Nosek has found, for example, that people in the 2nd Congressional District of New Jersey, which is nestled between the Delaware Bay and the Atlantic Ocean, have higher average levels of race bias than those in the 27th Congressional District in the Deep South of Texas, which includes the towns of Corpus Christi and Brownsville. Volunteers in Alabama's 1st Congressional District, centered around Mobile, show higher unconscious racial bias than those in the 9th Congressional District of California, which includes Oakland and Berkeley. Nosek overlaid his map of unconscious anti-black race bias on a map of electoral outcomes in all congressional races. He found a remarkable association between bias scores and political views. The higher the unconscious race bias scores in a congressional district, the more likely the district was to elect a Republican. The psychological research into the relationship between racial bias and political outcomes in the United States has focused mainly on bias against blacks. Ongoing research is exploring the effects of bias against other minorities. If racial bias had nothing to do with politics, and if the implicit association test was meaningless, as some of its critics have argued, there ought to be no correlation between bias scores and political orientation. But Nosek saw a very clear pattern. On average, districts with the greatest racial bias were more likely to vote for conservatives, and districts with the lowest racial bias tended to vote liberal. The difference, it should be emphasized, was a matter of degree. Large numbers of people in the Bay Area revealed the same anti-black or pro-white attitudes as people in Mobile, Alabama. But on a sliding scale, some areas showed greater levels of bias than others. This doesn't mean that you can look at a district's race bias scores and automatically predict whether the district will elect a Republican or a Democrat. As I said, bias is only one factor in people's political views, and it is far from being the most important factor. Some of the districts with the lowest bias scores, such as the 2nd Congressional District of Idaho, which includes the towns of Idaho Falls and Pocatello, are strongly Republican, while some districts with high bias scores, such as the 1st Congressional District of North Carolina, elected a Democrat in 2006 and 2008. There are places where race bias appears to be irrelevant to election outcomes, and places where it seems to play a substantial role. But of the 10 congressional districts with the highest bias scores among white voters, 8 were won by Republicans in the 2008 elections, and only 2 by Democrats. The 10 districts with the lowest bias scores revealed the opposite pattern: 7 were won by Democrats and only 3 by Republicans. Race bias scores predicted not only whether liberals or conservatives got elected, but what kind of liberals and conservatives got elected. Fully half the districts with the lowest bias scores elected people of color. Only one district with the highest bias scores elected a person of color, and he was a Democrat. 5 of the 7 Democrats elected in the districts with the lowest bias scores were Asian, Hispanic, and African American. All the Republicans elected in the districts with the highest bias scores were white. In 2 of the districts with the highest bias scores, the 1st Congressional District of Alabama and the 9th Congressional District of North Carolina, control of the seat switched from one political party to the other in the middle of the civil rights movement. This was part of the dramatic shift in the American South away from the Democratic Party in the 1960s, owing to the Democratic Party's support of civil rights legislation that guaranteed voting rights and dismantled legalized segregation. The first congressional district of Alabama elected Democrats from 1877 to 1963, 86 years, but elected a Republican in every subsequent election through 2008. The 9th Congressional District of North Carolina had elected a Democrat for 22 straight years before 1963. Starting in 1964, the district elected Republicans for more than four straight decades. Since we are talking about science, we ought to examine the research with a skeptical eye. Is the link between racial bias scores and political orientation merely a correlation, or is there a causative connection? If you see a lot of people holding umbrellas and wearing rain boots, it would be wrong to say that wearing rain boots causes people to hold umbrellas. The two things are related, but one does not cause the other. Both are caused by something else, the fact that it is raining. Could an unrelated third factor be responsible for both racial bias and political orientation? Second, isn't it possible that the connection between race and politics is better explained by simple demographics? People of color tend to vote for Democrats, so there ought to be a connection between diversity and whether a district elects a Republican or a Democrat. What does racial bias tell us that the racial makeup of a district does not? The question about correlation and causation cannot be answered with certainty. It is possible that the connection between race bias and political conservatism is only a correlation. The only way to prove causation is to conduct the kind of experiment that is impossible in real life. You change some people's unconscious racial attitudes and see if their political orientation fluctuates in response. If it does, you know that racial attitudes are influencing how people think about politics. No sect believes the relationship flows in both directions, race bias contributes to conservatism, and vice versa, and that both might also be influenced by other factors. People who are sensitive to threat, for example, tend to adopt conservative views and are also suspicious of people from other groups. The second question, the interaction between racial bias and racial makeup, has a clear answer. The demographic makeup of a district seems to act like a switch that sometimes brings racial bias into play, and sometimes eliminates it from the equation. Anti-black race bias does not seem to play much of a role in districts that have very few black people. It is only when a district starts to show an element of diversity that unconscious race bias seems to influence voting decisions. In other words, everyday contact between whites and blacks appears necessary to make bias salient, to bring into play racial attitudes that lurk beneath the surface. Remember the study by Jennifer Eberhardt into sentencing disparities? The sentencing disparities showed up only in cases involving black-on-white crime, not in cases involving same-race crime. In the same way, the presence of blacks in a congressional district seems to make race bias relevant to the voting decisions of whites. But when there are a very large number of blacks in a district, the connection between race bias and political orientation among white voters is drowned out by the fact that blacks tend to vote for Democrats, and so districts that have a lot of blacks invariably end up electing Democrats. White voters in congressional districts where racial minorities make up more than, say, 40% of the electorate certainly tend to vote Republican. The presence of minorities makes race relevant to the voting decisions of whites, but the tidal wave of people of color voting in the other direction renders that bias irrelevant. So, again, when there are few or no minorities, race bias doesn't seem to have much of an effect on political outcomes, the switch is turned off. And when there are lots of minorities, the effect of racial bias is again irrelevant because the tendency of whites to vote Republican in these areas is cancelled out by the tendency of blacks and other minorities to vote for Democrats. Race bias seems to tip congressional seats only in districts where you have both high bias scores among whites and a minority population that is sizable enough to be visible in everyday settings but not so large as to control the congressional district's electoral destiny. NOSEC estimated that race bias accounted for no more than 10% of the political variation in the country overall, hardly decisive, except in close races. Even this relatively small effect, however, produces clear patterns nationally between racial attitudes and voting outcomes. Many conservatives plaintively ask why psychologists don't spend more time analyzing the voting behavior of people of color. Nearly all African American voters, for example, voted for Barack Obama in the 2008 presidential election. People of color, in general, vote overwhelmingly for Democrats. Isn't this a bias, too? It certainly is. I don't think it is an unconscious bias, however. Many people of color enthusiastically supported Obama because they wanted to elect the first non-white president. This is emphatically not the case with unconscious race bias and conservatism. White voters tell us that race has nothing to do with their political views. If most research focuses on the biases of white voters, it is also because these biases matter more. There are more white voters in the United States than voters who are people of any other race, and a bias that affects whites is likely to be consequential in a way that a bias among a minority group is not. History also tells us what to focus on. We have never had a female president, so it would be silly to spend time studying why some voters may be biased in favor of women instead of asking why voters are biased in favor of men. Making connections between racial bias and politics always gets people upset. But if you look at this data calmly, you can say two things. 1. The race bias data does not provide liberals with a cudgel with which to bash conservatives. Yes, it is true that, on average, districts with higher bias scores tend to vote Republican and districts with lower bias scores tend to vote for Democrats, but the fact is that race bias is surprisingly common across political orientations. A large majority of Americans, including substantial numbers of African Americans, hold negative associations with black faces and positive associations with white faces. But it is undeniably true that there is a steady association between higher racial bias scores and a conservative orientation, on this and other psychological tests. We do not know whether race bias makes people politically conservative, whether conservatism tends to prompt people to adopt racially biased attitudes, or whether some third factor causes both. But if you are a patriotic Republican who passionately believes in the American ideal that all people are created equal, these results ought to be disconcerting. In the 1980s, the Democratic pollster Stan Greenberg identified a group of voters in Macomb County, Michigan. They were blue-collar workers, often union members, who had been staunch Democrats for decades. They voted their pocketbooks, and it was the Democratic Party that defended their economic interests. But starting in the mid-1960s, a substantial number of these voters switched parties. Greenberg found that in the 1980s, these voters supported Ronald Reagan, and Greenberg dubbed them Reagan Democrats, a term that has endured. Every 4 years, the national and international media descend on Macomb County ahead of presidential elections to see what the Reagan Democrats are up to. A few years ago, the plaintiff book What's the Matter with Kansas? Asked why so many blue-collar folks were voting Republican, when their economic interests lay with the Democratic Party. Author Thomas Frank concluded, in large part, that these voters were influenced by hot-button cultural issues such as abortion, gay rights, and guns. Frank argued that the Reagan Democrats ought to vote their pocketbooks by supporting labor rights, progressive taxation, business regulation, healthcare reform, and other policies traditionally championed by the left. Republican politicians typically ask voters to vote their values, often defined by evangelical Christianity, ahead of class and pocketbook, particularly when it comes to issues such as abortion and the role of religion in public life. This is all perfectly acceptable grounds for disagreement. Liberals can disagree with someone who votes for president using abortion as a litmus test, and conservatives can disagree with voters who do not place religious values at the core of their political beliefs. But both sides have to acknowledge that these are all legitimate ways to determine one's political choices. However, many Democratic pollsters have argued that the Reagan Democrats' switch in political allegiance was not made on legitimate grounds. Rather, the switch was driven by an issue that we can all agree ought to be illegitimate in politics, racial bias. Let's start with what polls and electoral data tell us. If only white people could vote in U.S. presidential elections, the Republican candidate would always win. Democrats did not capture the majority of the white vote in a single presidential election between 1964 and 2008, including during back-to-back wins by Bill Clinton in the 1990s and Barack Obama's landslide victory in 2008. Successful Democratic presidential candidates managed to split the white vote, or get close, and then win a majority among people of color. White men in particular have overwhelmingly drifted away from the Democratic Party, and this trend more than any other has produced Republican victories in two-thirds of the presidential elections held between 1964 and 2008. If only white men were allowed to vote in elections in the United States today, it would be a complete waste of money to conduct an election at all. Pollsters will tell you that it is inconceivable for Democratic presidential candidates to win or even split the votes of white males. When successful Democratic candidates manage to split the overall white vote, it is usually because they reduce the magnitude of their loss among white men and gain an advantage among white women. For all of the talk of Barack Obama's post-racial win in the 2008 presidential race, he would have lost in a landslide if the election had been limited to white voters. Obama won only 43% of the white vote nationwide and less than a third of white voters in the South. According to the National Election Pool exit poll, conducted by Edison/Mitofsky, only 28% of Southern white men voted for Obama. Such numbers usually portend defeat for Democrats. Obama overcame his poor showing among white voters by racking up mammoth support among younger voters and people of color. But the fact that whites, and white men in particular, tend to vote Republican is not sufficient to conclude that racial bias is at work. If you were to talk to the blue-collar voters of Macomb County who moved away from the Democratic Party, most would emphatically tell you they were not motivated by racial animus. To many, even the suggestion would be offensive. And it is not as though Republican politicians make overt pleas to racial bias. Very often, race is never even mentioned in campaign materials, stump speeches, and party platforms. Most presidential elections, moreover, have featured two white males running against each other. So how do we know that the charge of race bias is not a fiction dreamed up by Democratic partisans who are unhappy that a group of voters have drifted away from their column? Let's look at the issues that many of these blue-collar voters themselves cite to explain why they drifted away from the Democratic Party over the last quarter century. These voters gravitated toward conservative candidates before gay marriage and abortion became hot issues. Concerns about crime, welfare, and affirmative action topped their list of concerns starting in the 1970s, and it is these issues, along with more recent concerns about drugs and illegal immigration, that have provided Republican candidates with their most potent electoral weapons. Affirmative action has an explicitly racial component to it, so let's leave it out of the discussion. But there is nothing inherently racial about welfare or crime, is there? You have white families on welfare and black families on welfare, law-abiding whites and law-abiding blacks, white criminals and black criminals. Who can disagree that there ought to be less crime and fewer people dependent on public assistance? Conservatives have long provided a rational if debatable argument against welfare. They've argued that it provides perverse economic incentives for broken families and that it encourages laziness. If single mothers with children can get welfare while married mothers with children do not, does this not create an incentive for mothers to have their children raised in single-parent households? If you tie the size of a family's welfare check to the number of children a single mother is supporting, doesn't it create a perverse incentive for her to have many more children than she could raise successfully? And since welfare programs are directed primarily at the poor, doesn't the regular arrival of a check from the government discourage the poor from working? If welfare recipients were to go out and get even a moderately well-paying job, the check would stop. These are the familiar talking points of the anti-welfare argument. Here is how the Conservative Heritage Foundation puts it: higher welfare payments do not assist children, they increase dependence and illegitimacy, which have a devastatingly negative effect on children's development. It is welfare dependence, rather than poverty, which has the most negative effect on children. Whatever your political views, and regardless of whether you agree with the Heritage Foundation's thesis, all sensible people ought to be concerned about the potentially perverse effects of an ostensibly high-minded program. In all of this discussion, voters and politicians emphatically tell us that race plays no role in their feelings about welfare. But is this true? This is precisely the kind of question that social psychologists have studied for decades. When people say bias plays no role, there are good reasons to believe they are telling pollsters what they believe to be true. They are not saying race is irrelevant when they secretly know it matters. In their hearts, these voters likely feel no racial animus. But that does not tell us what is going on in their hidden brains. What kind of a mental image springs to the minds of these voters when you speak to them about welfare or crime? If race bias plays no role, it ought to be just as likely for white welfare recipients or white criminals to come to mind as black welfare recipients and black criminals. Researchers have conducted a number of experiments along these lines. The basic idea behind the experiments is very simple. You divide a group of white voters at random into two groups and give them campaign materials criticizing welfare, using the race-neutral arguments of the Heritage Foundation. One group, however, hears about the problem through the use of an illustrative white family on welfare, another hears about the problem through an illustrative black family on welfare. If the debate around welfare is only about personal responsibility, dignity of work, and economic fairness, it should make no difference that one group sees a black family while another group sees a white family. The issue has nothing to do with race, so you would expect there would be just as many people in each of these groups who are persuaded that welfare is, or isn't, a problem. On the other hand, if race is an issue, never explicitly mentioned, but a factor in the hidden brain, then the group that hears about the issue through an illustrative black family should end up being more critical of welfare than the group that hears about the problem through an illustrative white family. The same would go for crime. If lowering crime is a race-neutral issue, as it ostensibly ought to be, it ought to make no difference if you make a pitch about the importance of reducing crime to one group of voters using an illustrative black criminal and a pitch to another group of voters using an illustrative white criminal. Martin Jelenz at Princeton University once conducted an experiment along these lines. He asked a number of white Americans about their views on welfare. He then gave them an example of a woman in her 30s who had a 10-year-old child and was on welfare. Jelenz told some volunteers, picked at random, that the woman was black, and told others that the woman was white. He asked all the respondents their overall views on welfare. Jelenz found that volunteers had about the same level of negativity toward the white welfare mom as toward the black welfare mom, which seemingly supports the Heritage Foundation's argument that opposition to welfare is race neutral. But Jelenz found that negative attitudes toward the black welfare mom played a more powerful role than negative attitudes toward the white welfare mom in driving people's overall views about welfare. Seeing the benefits of welfare accrue to a black woman made volunteers significantly more hostile to welfare as a whole than seeing benefits accrue to a white woman. Jelenz also found that volunteers told about a welfare mom whose race was not identified automatically tended to invoke an image of a black woman rather than a white woman, even though there were more whites on welfare than blacks. More African Americans are on welfare as a proportion of the overall black population than is the case with whites. But if I sit a welfare recipient behind a screen and ask you to guess his or her race, it is absolute numbers that count, not ratios. Since there are more whites who receive welfare than blacks, the odds are that the person behind the screen will be white. Why do so many people believe the person will be black? Jelenz eventually concluded that unconscious racial attitudes were the single most important determinant of welfare views among his white volunteers. It was not that their opinions about self-reliance and individualism did not matter, they did. But if you took a group of people with the same views about self-reliance, hard work, and personal responsibility and talked to them about welfare, they were much more likely to automatically visualize a black person than a white person. Thinking about a black person, moreover, prompted many more people to decide they were against welfare in general, because negative opinions about blacks on welfare were more potent than negative opinions about whites on welfare. What does this mean if you are a political strategist or a politician who is hoping, cynically or instinctively, to take advantage of racial bias? It means that all you have to do is talk about welfare in general, and voters' hidden brains will do the rest for you. This does not mean that every politician who expresses a concern about welfare queens is motivated by race bias. The insidious thing is that it is impossible to tell whether a given politician is raising a concern about welfare because of his or her ideological beliefs about self-reliance or because he or she is trying to exploit racial bias, or both. Short of conducting an experiment, it is similarly impossible to tell if a given voter's views stem from a belief in self-reliance or from racial bias, or both. You can instantly see why this is a potent political tool. Racial appeals can now be embedded in a conversation that ostensibly has nothing to do with race. The same phenomenon is true with crime. George H.W. Bush's use of the Willie Horton ad in the 1988 presidential election is widely credited with his demolition of Democrat Michael Dukakis. Horton was a convicted murderer in Massachusetts who raped and stabbed a Maryland woman while on a weekend furlough. Dukakis, as governor of Massachusetts, inherited the furlough program from a prior governor and eventually shut it down, but Bush painted him as being slow to dismantle the program and therefore soft on crime. Much was made of the ad because it lingered on the image of Horton's black face, and Bush was accused of exploiting racial bias. But the photo was just the icing. It's hardly necessary to show a black man's face to evoke the image of a black criminal in the minds of white voters. All you have to do is talk about crime in general and their hidden brains will supply a picture of a violent black man. Many other issues work the same way. Everyone can agree that the drug trade has devastated communities, but if talk about drugs unconsciously and automatically evokes an image of black people smoking crack rather than white people snorting cocaine, or if people have greater fears about drug dealers who are black or brown than about drug dealers who are white, you can exploit race bias without ever making a reference to race. Ditto for illegal immigration. If talk of illegal aliens brings a Hispanic person to mind rather than a white immigrant, or if Hispanic illegal immigrants conjure a more threatening and malevolent picture in our minds than white illegal immigrants, you can appeal to race bias without ever mentioning, even to yourself, that the real problem you have with illegal immigration is brown people. The psychologist Robert W. Livingston once told volunteers about a crime in which a Milwaukee woman had been severely injured following an assault by an illegal immigrant. Some volunteers were told the criminal was from Canada and named David Edmonds. Others were told the criminal was from Mexico and named Juan Luis Martinez. Livingston asked his volunteers to play juror and decide on an appropriate prison sentence. The volunteers recommended a longer prison sentence for the Mexican, even though both fictional illegal immigrants had committed exactly the same crime. Once people's attitudes are influenced by bias, even their basic perception of facts can change. In 1982, at a time when Ronald Reagan was drumming up concerns about welfare, a CBS/New York Times survey asked people this question: of all the people who are poor in this country, are more of them black or are more of them white? More than half of all Americans believed there were more poor black people than poor white people in the United States. African Americans at the time constituted 28% of Americans who were poor, according to U.S. Census Bureau definitions of poverty. In a more recent survey of Illinois voters some years ago, when the issue of welfare reform was very hot, more than 60% of respondents overestimated, by a factor of 100%, the number of Americans who were on welfare. One in three volunteers grossly overestimated the number of African Americans on welfare, and two in five overestimated the size of welfare payments that families received. 90% of the respondents greatly overestimated the amount of the federal budget spent on welfare. The errors were not small. There was not one factual question related to welfare where the majority of respondents got the right answer, or even came close. Americans believed that welfare recipients were more numerous, more lucratively compensated, and more likely to be black than the facts warranted. Those who made the largest errors, and believed the most inaccurate facts, were often the most confident about the accuracy of their views. It was all the doing of the hidden brain, of course, and a gold mine for politicians willing to exploit such bias. All of us can agree there are issues that are not matters of preference but matters of fact, Mahzarin Banaji once told me. The reason this is powerful is, it shows our minds will not just distort our preferences, but distort facts. I believe that, like bias among Francis Aboud's preschoolers, voters can end up with racial bias in adulthood without ever intending to be biased, without anyone deliberately instilling bias in their hearts, and with everyone trying their utmost not to be biased. I am not suggesting that political campaigns do not explicitly exploit racial fears by talking about welfare, crime, and illegal immigration, they do. But the reason those campaigns work is that when you talk about those issues, it is minorities who automatically spring to the minds of many voters. Why do so many Americans automatically think of a black criminal or a black welfare recipient when they think about crime and welfare? The fact that disproportionate numbers of African Americans are poor and do get in trouble with the law does not explain why so many people automatically bring blacks to mind during discussions of crime and welfare. As the Illinois survey showed, many people don't merely think more blacks as a proportion of the black population receive welfare than do whites, they overestimate the absolute number of blacks on welfare. If the perception of black poverty and criminality is out of line with the statistical evidence, where does it come from? Part of the answer has been well explored. Media representations of criminals and welfare recipients are often skewed. Media coverage regularly reflects existing stereotypes. The black murderer seems more newsworthy than the white murderer, and the heightened news coverage of certain crimes in turn strengthens the stereotype. But I believe there is a more important explanation, and it is rather mundane. As I said at the start, we seek dramatic explanations for dramatic phenomena. Much of the hidden brain's power, however, lies in the fact that its influence is subtle and mundane. Even if media coverage were not biased and the proportion of people on welfare and in trouble with the law were absolutely identical among all ethnic groups, large numbers of Americans would still mentally inflate the number of minorities who are poor or violent and undercount the number of whites who are poor or violent. Minorities have a disproportionate risk of being linked with negative associations for no better reason than that they are minorities. You can show this in everyday settings that are less emotionally charged than welfare and crime. Divide a group of 100 people into two groups, A and B, with 80 of them assigned to group A and 20 of them assigned to group B. Make everyone in group A wear red and everyone in group B wear blue, so that every person's group membership is visible and easily identifiable. Tell all the people about 10 instances when members of these groups took an unauthorized cookie from the cookie jar. 8 of the cookie stealers were from group A and 2 from group B. If you later ask people in group A to guess the total number of cookie stealers in each group, they are likely to overestimate the number of cookie stealers in group B and underestimate the number of cookie stealers in group A. They may even feel that there are a larger number of cookie stealers in group B than in group A. When you mention cookie stealing to someone from group A person from group B can come more readily to mind. People in group A, in other words, can greatly overestimate the number of cookie stealers in group B for no better reason than that group B is smaller than group A, and everyone belonging to groups A and B are clearly identifiable. Aberrational things done by people in a highly visible minority group stick up in our minds more dramatically than aberrational things done by members of a majority group. The technical term for this phenomenon is an illusory correlation. If you ask people in Thailand whether Thai men or white male tourists from the United States are more likely to be child molesters, they can easily tell you that there are more American pedophiles than locals. That's because, in Thailand, white males are a highly visible minority. Aberrational things that they do will be more memorable to Thai people than aberrational things done by locals. There is experimental evidence to back up what I have just told you. Researchers once divided volunteers into two groups. Both were shown a 15-minute excerpt of a local TV news program. In the middle of the newscast, right after a commercial break, the volunteers saw a story involving a violent crime. The story featured a photograph of a suspect. Without the volunteers' knowledge, researchers digitally altered the complexion of the suspect so that some volunteers saw a suspect who appeared white while others saw a suspect who appeared black. Every other detail of the crime story remained identical. As with the welfare study, the experiment showed that viewers shown the photo of a black suspect ended up more worried about crime than those shown the photograph of a white suspect. But that was not all. Volunteers shown a white suspect did not associate criminality with whites as a whole, but volunteers shown a black suspect tended to associate criminality with blacks as a whole. Jalen similarly found that his volunteers didn't think that black welfare recipients were lazy, they thought blacks as a whole were lazy. This is how illusory correlations work. When two unusual events take place simultaneously, our hidden brain subtly biases us to see the events as linked, even if they have nothing to do with each other. The consequences of this bias can be gigantic, but the underlying phenomenon is mundane and shows up in innumerable everyday contexts. If you happen to have stomach upsets on two mornings because of something you ate, and you also happen to be catching flights on each of those days, your hidden brain will bias you into believing that flights bring on stomach upsets. If the error were limited to believing that those two flights brought on a bad stomach, it would be one thing. But the bias causes you to believe that all flights bring on stomach upsets. How can we defend against such bias in politics? The troubling thing is that most voters, and perhaps most politicians, do not understand where their attitudes and beliefs and facts come from. At an explicit level, people may talk and think only about issues. They worry about crime, illegal immigration, and drugs. There is nothing biased about this. It is perfectly legitimate to want to see less crime, to want to see immigration laws enforced, and to want to control the abuse and trafficking of narcotics. Critics of tough immigration, drug, and crime policies would be wrong to suggest that these concerns stem entirely from racial bias. In the absence of racial bias, concerns about crime and drugs and illegal immigration would hardly disappear. But race bias prompts people to think differently about these issues, and prompts a few more people in every hundred to adopt stances that they might not have adopted otherwise. It also poisons our ability to honestly debate these issues, or even agree on basic facts. And because appeals to unconscious bias do not have to be spoken about or even thought about deliberately, the manipulation is almost completely immune to refutation. How do you refute something that ostensibly does not exist? When explicit claims about race are made, they can be rebutted, but when blacks are linked with crime, welfare, or drug use only implicitly, such links are less likely to be challenged, Jalen once wrote. Thus, a subterranean discourse on race in U.S. society emerges, based largely on misleading images and chosen to influence voters by inciting fear or indignation. Rarely does one hear public figures make the explicit claim that irresponsible black mothers are the problem with welfare or that violence-prone black men are the reason our streets are unsafe at night. But since they are not being made, such claims are not refuted. The public is left to draw its own conclusions, based on existing stereotypes and biased media coverage, and the conclusions drawn are exactly what one would expect. A few months before the 2008 presidential elections, the secretary-treasurer of the AFL-CIO, Richard L. Trumka, told colleagues about an encounter he'd had with an old friend in his hometown of Namaqualand, Pennsylvania. The Democratic primary race between Senators Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama was in high gear. I ran into a woman that I had known for years. She was active in Democratic politics back when I was in grade school, back when Abe Lincoln was born, Trumka joked at a union convention. Then he grew serious. We got to talking, and I asked her if she'd made up her mind who she was supporting, and she said, "Oh, absolutely. I am voting for Hillary. There's no way I'd ever vote for Obama." I said, "Why is that?" She said, "He is a Muslim." I said, "Actually, he is a Christian just like you and I, but so what if he's a Muslim?" Then she shook her head and said, "Well, he won't wear that American flag pin on his lapel." I looked at my lapel and said, "I don't have one, and by the way, you don't have one on, either, but come on, he wears one plenty of times. Besides, it takes more than wearing a flag pin to be patriotic." She said, "Well, I don't trust him." I said, "Why is that?" And she dropped her voice a bit. She said, "Because he is black." And I said, "Look around this town. Namaqualand's a dying town. There's no jobs here. Our kids are moving away because there is no future here. And here is a man, Barack Obama, who is going to fight for people like us, and you want to tell me that you won't vote for him because of the color of his skin? Are you out of your ever-loving mind, lady? Trump's comments were widely circulated. Polling by unions was finding that Obama's race was playing a role in the minds of many members. I think race bias does play a role, Karen Ackerman, the research director of the AFL-CIO, told me about a month before the 2008 election. We see it among union voters and in certain demographics, retirees and veterans, older voters. The Democratic pollster and political consultant Jalinda Lake told me she started to worry when polls taken by white pollsters and black pollsters among rank-and-file union members in battleground states started to come back with different answers. White union members told black pollsters they were going to vote for Obama, but told white pollsters that they were going to vote against Obama. Lake feared that many people were hiding their true feelings to black pollsters so as not to appear racist, and expressing their true intentions to white pollsters. Other polls showed that while nearly three-quarters of voters said they would be comfortable voting for a black man, fewer than half thought their neighbors would be comfortable doing so. I drove to northwestern Pennsylvania about 3 weeks before the 2008 election. The state had emerged as one of the major battlegrounds of the election. Polls showed Republican candidate John McCain struggling, but Democrats and Republicans agreed that if McCain was to thread the needle to victory, he would have to win Pennsylvania. If the Republican was to have any chance in Pennsylvania, he would have to win big in the suburbs and small rural and blue-collar towns such as St. Mary's, which sits at the edge of Appalachia in the northwest part of the state. St. Mary's is part of Pennsylvania's 5th congressional district, which is so sparsely populated that it occupies nearly a quarter of the land area of the entire state. Pennsylvania has 19 congressional districts. The 5th congressional district is overwhelmingly white and strongly Republican. On Brian Nosek's national race bias map, it scores high on racial bias. People from this district who have taken the implicit association race bias test tend to show higher levels of racial bias than about 75% of the congressional districts in the United States. As I drove off the interstate and onto the local roads that led to St. Mary's, I was acutely conscious, in ways I usually do not think about, that I was a person of color. It did not help that, in the matter of a single hour, I got pulled over twice by police cruisers. In the first case, I had pulled to the side of a road to look at a map. When I glanced up, there was a cruiser behind me with lights blazing. The cop gave my car a quick once-over and sent me on my way. In the second case, I was following a couple of slow cars on a two-lane road. I glanced at my speedometer, the cars were going around 45 miles an hour. The speed limit was 55. On a clear stretch of road where passing was permitted, I overtook the vehicles, stepping hard on the gas to get around them as quickly as possible. The cop who pulled me over a few moments later said the cars I had overtaken had been going 65 miles an hour, and that he had tracked me going 10 miles per hour faster than that, 20 miles above the speed limit. I felt rattled. When the cop returned after checking my driving record to give me a speeding ticket, I told him, defensively, that I was an extremely safe driver who had never received a moving violation in nearly two decades on the road. Frankly, he snapped, "That surprises me. I thought about that afterward." The cop had known me barely a minute. In that narrow window, how had he formed a general conclusion about me that would cause him to feel surprise at the two decades of accumulated evidence in my driving record? What might have happened if the driving data had not existed and the cop had had only his intuition to guide him? The Republican vice presidential candidate Sarah Palin held a rally in Pennsylvania that same day. Videos taken outside the rally by Obama supporters showed dozens of Republicans yelling comments straight into cameras, "Barack Hussein Obama, go back to Kenya," and "The only difference between Obama and Osama is the BS." The comments might have been isolated and amplified by selective editing, but they did seem to evoke widespread laughter among the all-white crowd. An older man carried a monkey with a headband. "This is little Hussein," the man said, laughing. Others yelled, "Obama bin Laden, go back to Africa," and "Born in Kenya, citizen of Indonesia." Then there was, "We need a Muslim president." If he gets in office, he's not going to have a cross-section of America in his cabinet. It is going to be Al Sharpton, Reverend Jeremiah. Right, Jesse Jackson. This isn't an Oprah show. When McCain and Palin were pressed by journalists to address comments being made by their supporters at rallies, including occasional recommendations of violence against Obama, the candidates said the comments were restricted to a small minority that in no way spoke for the majority. Union members belonging to the local Communications Workers of America in St. Mary's were canvassing union households the day I visited. I had arranged to walk around town with a 54-year-old organizer named Roseanne Barker, a heavyset white woman with a square face, short bobbed hair, and an affable attitude. Barker worked for the Northwestern Pennsylvania Area Labor Federation based in Franklin, and lived outside Erie. She had driven a couple of hours that morning to St. Mary's. Barker told me she didn't think race was a big factor in her part of the state. I also met Rick Zimmerman, the president of local CWA 502 in St. Mary's. He wore a t-shirt and, like nearly every other male union member I met, blue jeans. I don't see any Obama signs, maybe people are tearing them down at night, he told me with a grin. They say St. Mary's is a prejudiced town. We don't have many colored people around here. Barker and I set off to one neighborhood. She had a list of union household addresses, and planned to knock on doors and give people her union's views of the candidates. Canvassing is a tiring and generally unrewarding business. There are long stretches of locked doors and impassive faces, interspersed with threatening bulldogs and people who enthusiastically support the candidate you want to see elected. The actual targets of canvassing efforts, people who are undecided or against your candidate but still amenable to persuasion, are few and far between. I introduced myself as a journalist to every person I met. Linda Emirat, who was sweeping her driveway with a long broom, told us that she thought all politicians were a bunch of crooks. I wanted Huckabee, she said, referring to the Republican presidential candidate Mike Huckabee, a favorite with evangelical voters. It felt like he was more in tune with the person who goes out and sweeps the driveway. The others talk down to us. They use words that I sometimes think, what the H are they talking about? I think Obama is telling people what he thinks they want to hear. They've got forked tongues. Mark Flasinski, whom I met on the street, said, I don't think Obama is the answer. I don't think McCain is the answer, either, but I think he is the best of two evils. Every person I met who was younger than 40 said they were for Obama. Nearly every person older than 60 said they were undecided or for McCain. Other groups of union members had fanned out across St. Mary's. One voter told union canvasser Terry O'Connor that he thought Obama was a Muslim. Another told O'Connor he was not going to vote for Obama but was going to vote a straight Democratic ticket for all other offices. We're in Appalachia, and this is the Bible Belt, O'Connor told me, as if this were sufficient explanation. The problematic ones are the rural white voters, 50 to 60 and up. We're going to win a lot of them, but open-mindedness is not something they are known for. I don't mind people voting for McCain because of abortion, but not because people think Obama is a Muslim. Gary Bittner, a union organizer who works in 28 of Pennsylvania's western counties, told me, as he chain-smoked cigarettes, that there was a cultural issue related to Obama. They are scared of what they don't know. I tell them, what's important to you, your job, health care, pension benefits. Bittner said that Obama's race was often an undertow in conversations. I asked him to give me an example. It gets said, but not in polite conversation, Bittner replied. Let's say there is a text message going around saying, Barack Obama will get shot 8 minutes into his presidency. There are people who find that funny. At the American Legion later that day, I engaged an older white man in conversation. His name was Don Jote and he was 73. He was a lifelong Democrat who always voted a straight party ticket. But he said he was uncomfortable about Obama. I asked him what issues were of concern to him in the election. Jote said the economy and jobs were his principal worries. He said he disliked free trade agreements that were bringing in a flood of cheap imports. As a result of imports from China, Joe told me, the light bulb factory he had worked at for 37 years had seen its workforce shrink from 1,600 employees to 350. I really don't know which way to go, Jote said. I've been a Democrat all my life, but I don't know what to think about this election. Tax-wise and everything else, I don't know what to think. I asked him whether he knew which presidential candidate was more in favor of the free trade that he vehemently opposed. Jote said he thought that McCain, who had vocally insisted that he was a much fiercer advocate of free trade than Obama, was more sympathetic to the cause of protectionism. I am not sure about Obama, Jote said. I am not sure if I can trust him. If Hillary had stayed in the race, I would have voted for her. Zimmerman took me to the home of a colleague, a 68-year-old white woman who had worked at his union for 40 years. The woman came barefoot into her yard to talk to me. We stood below a maple tree, as her dog, a cross between a cocker spaniel and a collie, wandered about. Two large flags hung from her porch, an American flag and a Vietnam Pau Mia flag. When I talked to her, the woman agreed to be identified, but she called me urgently a day later to request I not mention her name. She said she was born in St. Mary's and had always lived there. She was a lifelong Democrat, and despised the Republican candidates in the 2008 election. Among other things, she thought the government had no business telling women what to do with their bodies. She was fiercely pro-choice. She loved everything about Hillary Clinton. But when Obama won the Democratic nomination, she said she could not bring herself to support him. From what I see, the blacks get entries into college and free loans, Latinos, too, she said. I am opposed to affirmative action. She told me she had been concerned that if Obama won the presidency, the interests of white people would be cast aside. I was worried I would have to go to the back of the bus. She acknowledged that Obama's race was a concern. But then, she told me, she had a talk with her sister, an Obama supporter. The sister convinced her that Obama would not send white people to the back of the bus. She said she was reluctantly coming around to the idea of voting for Obama. I asked her what her sister had said about Obama that had changed her mind. My sister said, "You don't understand, he is white, too. He has a white mom and white grandparents. That had a lot to do with it. As you can see from these conversations, race bias is never completely implicit or completely explicit. Sometimes it lies beneath the surface, you think it is there, but you can't be certain. Other times, you don't have to think at all." Days before the election, the canvasser Roseanne Barker and I had another conversation. She sounded distressed. A large number of signs had appeared overnight in her residential community. The signs consisted of just four words printed on a small sheet of paper: "Vote right, vote white." Elsewhere, she told me, in a repost to Obama's "Change You Can Believe In" slogan, signs said, "Change means, come help another nigger get elected." Barker's voice choked. She said she had raced around the neighborhood taking down the signs. I didn't think it was so prevalent, but boy, the billboard signs and these laminated pages, it shows that in the rural community I live in, there is a race problem, she said. It is my community, the place where I live. More than 100 of these signs had to be taken down. I never dreamed someone would go to that extent. I knew there was prejudice but didn't think it was to that extent. The Chicago O'Hare Hilton Hotel is located within the complex of the busiest airport in the United States. From airport terminals, short walkways put you under the 10-story hotel, which has a facade of black metal and tinted glass. On September 27, 2008, one day after the first 2008 presidential debate between Senators John McCain and Barack Obama, a small group of people from all over the United States flew into Chicago for a secret meeting at the Airport Hilton. Room 2020 in the West Wing of the Hilton had been reserved for the day. On a small plaque affixed outside the room were printed the words "Center for Social Inclusion." The room's interior was occupied by a large rectangular conference table and a dozen black leather chairs. Through the window, you could see shuttles from the Marriott Hotel and National Car Rental Company sweeping by the passenger arrival areas at the airport. From time to time, red and white trains going between terminals rumbled by in opposite directions on an elevated track. The meeting had been organized on short notice. Barely a week and a half had gone by since the group had informally coalesced through emails and conference calls. The people at the meeting were among the country's foremost thinkers on issues related to bias and politics. When Obama became the first African-American candidate to be nominated by a major political party, these experts decided they wanted to apply what scholars had learned about prejudice to combat bias in the election. From Washington, D.C., came Todd Rogers and Chelinda Lake, Democratic Party pollsters and consultants. From Los Angeles came Jerry Kong from the University of California. From New Jersey, Rachel Godsell of Seton Hall Law School. From Atlanta, Drew Weston, a political psychologist and Democratic Party consultant. From Philadelphia, Camille Charles, a sociologist at the University of Pennsylvania. There were several other community activists, political organizers, and academic researchers. Other experts who could not make it to Chicago called in and participated through a speakerphone. The group had been summoned by John Powell, a legal scholar at Ohio State University. If talk about welfare, illegal immigration, and crime were coded ways to talk about race, Powell wanted to come up with ways to deactivate such bias. The first way, the traditional way, was to uncover the bias. You combat subterranean bias, in other words, by bringing it to the surface. The Obama campaign had chosen a different route. Race was rarely to be made explicit, and the campaign never made a fuss about racism. Even in the face of explicit racism, thousands of people openly said that they would never vote for a black man. Obama stayed relentlessly positive. When people hurled racially tinged epithets at Obama at rallies, when some Republican Party leaders openly questioned the biracial candidate's religion, background, and patriotism, when Hillary Clinton publicly declared that Obama's support among working, hard-working Americans, white Americans, is weakening, the campaign responded with the same uplifting messages of unity that Obama had honed since his famous speech at the 2004 Democratic National Convention. Rather than accuse anyone of racial bias, the campaign preferred to call people to their better angels, to remind Americans that they were above racism. Obama's strategy had been successful. He had won the Democratic nomination. But Powell feared there would come a time when the strategy would no longer work. Powell's team had heard that Republicans were planning a major attack in the late fall, drawing on excerpts from Obama's books where he talked about using drugs as a young man and having devoured Marxist and feminist literature. And the speeches of Malcolm X. Powell reached out to the Obama campaign but was met with resistance. Initially, I tried to get the campaign to do it, and they were of the opinion that it wasn't necessary, Powell told me. My response is, if you are right, great, but what if you are wrong? You should have something ready. If you don't need it, no sweat, but if you want something and don't have it, you are in trouble. They are not taking advantage of the research in the last 30 years. They think talking about race is necessarily divisive. They don't realize people are very conflicted. Mahzarin Banaji called into the Chicago meeting from Harvard. The psychologist had long been a proponent of fighting unconscious bias by dragging it into the open, by making implicit biases visible. But in this situation, she felt Obama was doing the right thing. All politicians, she told me, had to emphasize the bond they had with voters, and it made sense that Obama should stay clear of the subject of race. The bond that a member of a minority group has with most voters cannot be the thing that marks him as a minority. The group discussed different ways in which campaign advertisements have exploited race bias. In the 2006 Senate election in Tennessee, African American candidate Harold Ford was the target of an ad that played on miscegenation fears. The ad featured a young white woman who claimed to have met Ford at a Playboy party, and ended with her seductively whispering, "Harold, call me." One anti-Obama ad showed the candidate's grinning face morph into the face of a wolf. A conservative group linked Obama with Kwame Kilpatrick, the disgraced black mayor of Detroit, who had recently been ejected from office on criminal charges. As the ad listed the various charges against Kilpatrick, it showed footage of Obama standing with Kilpatrick and praising him. The ad advised voters to learn who Obama's friends were. Kilpatrick's skin is much darker than Obama's, and the ad deliberately darkened Kilpatrick's complexion even further to play on the unconscious biases of white voters against dark-skinned black men, according to sociologist Camille Charles at the University of Pennsylvania. Toward the end of the day, I asked the group around the table how Obama might be vulnerable to unconscious bias. Powell, who wore a beard speckled with gray, said that Obama was not vulnerable in the way African American leaders usually are. Obama could not be depicted as threatening. But he was vulnerable to suggestions that he was an outsider and foreign. His middle name was Hussein, and he had spent long stretches of his childhood in other countries. It was the "he's not one of us" message that Powell was worried about. "The primary target is the Reagan Democrats," Powell told me. "People who belong to unions, who in Ohio voted for Democratic Governor Ted Strickland. Strickland won by a huge margin. It helped that his opponent was a black Republican. You don't have to convince them that unions are good, or governments have a role, and wouldn't it be great to have health care?" If he lost, Powell concluded about Obama, it would be because people who agreed with Obama on the issues did not want to vote for a black man. It will be because of Democrats. The pollsters, consultants, and psychologists around the table in Chicago decided to devise a series of anti-bias messages and get them out to voters in battleground states. The group wanted to inoculate voters against divisive appeals. They planned to come up with a series of ads to get people to think about the role of race in the election. One would involve shoving an actual elephant into a diner as patrons chewed their food and took nervous glances at the behemoth. As the elephant flapped its ears, a message would say, "Let's talk about the elephant in the room." There was only one time in the 2008 election when the Obama campaign's strategy to neutralize the subject of race came completely undone. It was during the Democratic primary, when comments by Obama's pastor, the Reverend Jeremiah Wright of Trinity United Church of Christ in Chicago, surfaced in the national media. Wright had often lashed out at white America in sermons about racial injustice, and Obama's opponents seized on the pastor saying such things as, "Not God bless America. God damn America." The instant Obama found himself linked to Wright's inflammatory comments, his campaign stalled. Reporters later dug up comments made by John C. Hagee, a pastor whom John McCain had embraced, who once said the Holocaust was God's plan to drive Jews to Palestine. And Larry Croon, a pastor of Republican vice presidential nominee Sarah Palin, had said that God would strike the United States of America. On the same day as that first presidential debate, the Washington Post noted that in the fine, new American tradition of presidential campaign pastor disasters, Republican vice presidential nominee Sarah Palin might have won. It made intuitive sense that if Obama got into a heap of trouble because of his pastor's views, the same thing would happen to McCain and Palin. But that did not happen, and the people in room 2020 of the O'Hare Hilton could have told you why. The real issue with Wright was not his militant and overheated comments, but that contact with Wright unconsciously linked Obama to a notion toxic to many white voters, the angry black man who sought to make whites feel guilty about racism. There was no analogous identity archetype that Hagee and Croon evoked, certainly nothing to rival the deep fears and anxieties that the angry black man conjured. It made sense that the McCain and Palin pastor controversies would sink like stones. I found it interesting that even as the national media wrapped itself into pretzels about Wright's comments, many people of color found Wright utterly unremarkable. Before he parted ways with Wright, Obama himself said he felt his church was not particularly controversial. Wright was certainly inflammatory and given to rhetorical excess, but this partly had to do with the theatricality of sermons in general and the style of the black church in particular. Obama once said Wright is like an old uncle who says things I don't always agree with. But if Wright had a tendency toward overblown rhetoric, most blacks had little problem with the emotional truth of his message. African Americans are 447% more likely than white Americans to be imprisoned and 521% more likely to be murdered. There is a 5-to-1 wealth gap between whites and blacks at birth. Blacks live 5 years fewer on average than whites, and the black infant mortality rate is nearly 1.5 times the white infant mortality rate. Wouldn't it be odd not to be angry? But once Wright's comments surfaced in the national media, and excerpts from his sermons were replayed endlessly on cable television, it was no longer possible for the Obama campaign to sell its "We Are All Americans First" message. The America that Wright described felt like a cruel caricature to many whites. Which version of reality, Obama's opponents asked, did the candidate endorse? Hillary Clinton sat down for a lengthy interview with Bill O'Reilly of Fox News, and agreed with the conservative commentator that Obama had some explaining to do. Where the country had seen in Obama only a quiet, well-spoken Harvard-educated lawyer, the Wright episode raised questions about whether Obama was secretly the kind of militant black activist that many whites abhorred. Obama's first instinct was to let things blow over, but Wright, who could be described as Obama's friend in only the loosest sense of the term, held a televised meeting at the National Press Club in Washington, where he fought back against his critics, argued that they were motivated by racism, and charged that the attacks on him were attacks on the entire black community. Wright addressed his comments to a crowd of supporters, and they gave him a standing ovation. The press conference put Obama in an even more difficult bind. Shortly afterward, Obama renounced his ties with Wright and then did something he almost never did before or after in the 2008 campaign: he explicitly talked about race. In a now famous speech in Philadelphia, Obama presented a picture of race relations very different from that presented by his former pastor. He played conciliator, and explained to white people why black people were often angry, and explained to black people why white people were resentful of being reminded endlessly about the legacy of slavery. The country had come a long way since the days of Jim Crow, Obama reminded his black audience, but the country also had a long way still to go. The speech was psychologically astute, and precisely what a psychologist who studies the hidden brain would have recommended. The researchers Richard P. Ibick and Joyce Erlinger have shown that a central reason whites and blacks in America have very different impressions about the state of racial progress is that whites unconsciously compare the state of race relations with the past. Compared to the days of slavery, the country has made enormous strides in race relations, and many whites find it incomprehensible that blacks do not regularly acknowledge the progress that has been made. Ibick and Erlinger found that blacks, on the other hand, unconsciously compare the status quo with an idealized future where discrimination does not exist. For the young black man or woman who suffers subtle forms of discrimination in the workplace, it isn't much consolation to say things were worse 200 years ago. From this perspective, many blacks cannot understand why whites would downplay the reality of their everyday experience. Each side had a point, Obama effectively told his audience, and each side had more in common with the other than either believed. Without overtly looking like he was doing so, Obama also reminded white voters that he was half white. "I can no more disown him than I can my white grandmother," Obama said about his former pastor. The speech was made at the National Constitution Center, and Obama used the occasion to draw the country's attention to the document that bound the nation together. Rather than speak on behalf of any group, Obama spoke on behalf of everyone. The Philadelphia speech was a huge political success, and it revived the Obama campaign. Obama never seriously addressed the subject of race again, and in fact took great pains to avoid the subject altogether. For all the historic significance of an African-American man reaching for the presidency, one of the ironies of the Obama campaign is that it was largely mute when it came to the subject of race. At the Democratic National Convention in Denver, which was held on the 45th anniversary of the famous 1963 March on Washington, with an African-American man on the presidential ticket of a major party for the first time in history, John Powell pointed out to me, with some bitterness, that Obama never mentioned the words race, Martin Luther King, or civil rights in his acceptance speech. The documentary shown about his life, Powell added, was heavy on white people. It emphasized his mother's side of the family, his white side, far more than it did his father's side, even though in his book Dreams from My Father Obama emphasized how important it was for him to find his identity as a black man in order to become a leader. Powell told me, and remember, this was a man who was working 18 to 19 hours a day to get Obama elected, that he found the Philadelphia speech politically brilliant but historically problematic. Rather than talk about the problem of race in America, Obama had talked about the problem of anger in America. Whites were angry with blacks, blacks were angry with whites. If everyone renounced their anger, we would all be better off. But Powell could not abide the idea that black anger and white anger were equivalent and somehow canceled each other out. If blacks were angry about slavery and segregation, discrimination and a lack of opportunities, whites were angry because they felt undeserving blacks were taking advantage of the system. Dr. King, in his most important speeches, talked about the importance of righteous indignation, Powell told me. Obama understands that he is playing to a white audience. If he can be Tiger Woods and a non-threatening black, he thinks he can get the support of white people. Two undercurrents of discomfort ran beneath the table at the secret Chicago meeting. One had to do with the conflicting challenges of fighting bias and fighting to win an election. The people around the table knew that if they were against bias, they also had to be against the ageism and sexism that prompted voters to feel McCain was too old and that Sarah Palin was yet another incompetent woman. By the end of the meeting, Powell said the goal was less about getting Obama elected and more about removing bias from the equation. As long as voters did not reject a candidate because of bias, it was perfectly legitimate to vote for or against anyone. But there was another undercurrent that ran still deeper. When you found unconscious bias, there were two things you could do about it. You could fight it at an implicit level, as the Obama campaign was doing. Without ever making a fuss about racism, you could project counter-stereotypical messages that radiated calm and reassurance. The other approach was explicit: you called out voters who agreed with your candidate on the issues but were reluctant to vote for him because of racism. This would be the Martin Luther King, Jr., way, the path of righteous indignation. The trouble was, calling people out on racism made them defensive. Even if you won the argument, you could lose their vote. The Obama approach was much more astute politically, but there was something disturbing about it. If the only way for a black politician to be acceptable to whites was to project an image of a non-threatening black man, the exception to the rule, wasn't that implicitly an endorsement of the stereotype? These concerns would be amplified as the group designed a series of ads and tested them among a large number of undecided white voters in battleground states. Chalinda Lake ran the ads by 500 men and 500 women with blue-collar backgrounds, the people who told white pollsters one thing and black pollsters something else. Lake asked the voters what they made of each ad and how it made them feel. The psychologist Drew Weston measured how the ads changed unconscious attitudes toward Obama. The Elephant in the Room ad was an example of how bias might be combated explicitly. Another ad targeted the hidden brain. It involved a blue-collar worker speaking directly into the camera. One version featured a man, another a woman. The speaker articulated many of the concerns about Obama that were being circulated in white working-class communities, that Obama would give preference to black people, and that he was an unpatriotic outsider. The idea, said Weston, was to openly acknowledge what people were feeling. But rather than dismiss such concerns as racist or wrong, as the union leader Richard Trumka had done with his old friend in Namaqualand, Pennsylvania, the ad gave people an alternative way to think about their feelings. This was the text of the ad featuring a 50-ish white woman. The woman was identified as Sue Burton of Zanesville, Ohio. A lot of people aren't quite sure about Barack Obama. He seems steady. He talks about things that matter to me, the price of gas and groceries, and health care we can count on. But then sometimes I get that feeling, you know, uneasy. I'm not really sure who he is. Does he really love his country? Maybe if he gets elected, he's going to put the interests of black people above the interests of the rest of us. You know, I was talking with my mom about it. She and Dad had the same questions about President Kennedy before he was elected. They had that same feeling. Uneasy. Maybe he'd put his Catholic faith before his country. I'm not prejudiced. I just want to know that he shares my values and cares about people like me. And I think he does. I think he loves his two little girls just like I love mine. I think he loves our country just like I do. It hasn't been easy for me. But I'm going to give him a chance. I am an American, and so is he. The conventional way to counter an untruth is to confront it. Indeed, if you subscribe to the notion that people's conscious minds are all that matter, this is what you should do. Good information ought to drive bad information out of circulation. It's only when you think about politics with the hidden brain in mind that you understand why innumerable fact-checking websites and media articles ahead of the 2008 presidential election did little to prevent millions of Americans from believing blatant falsehoods about Obama. The "I am an American" ad took a different tack. It set aside the conscious mind altogether and focused entirely on the hidden brain. Rather than tell people that the allegations against Obama were false, the ad took the point of view of people who felt uneasy. It was an old lesson from therapy textbooks: regardless of whether feelings were justified, they were real. You cannot eliminate feelings by denying their validity; indeed, denying them usually strengthened them. The "I am an American" ad did not present refutations to the woman's beliefs or try to show that her feelings were unjustified or wrong. Rather, it was the woman herself who made the emotional decision to override her fears. She wasn't being corrected. She was being courageous. The message tested well in focus groups, but some funders, Weston told me, were uncomfortable about a message that did not explicitly refute untrue insinuations about Obama. The notion of setting aside the conscious mind and focusing only on the hidden brain can be difficult to swallow. But if you refute it, it has a different meaning, Weston said. My conscious concern about the refutation is it sounds contrived. This does not sound like a person who has struggled with this. It sounds like an Obama campaign worker. The experts tested a number of other approaches. One ad called Team USA showed a girls' soccer match in progress with the soundtrack of America the Beautiful in the background. A series of adorable black and white children played together, intensely focused on the game, with smiles and camaraderie. It then showed a close-up shot of Joe Jacoby, a white Olympic gold medal winner in white water canoeing, followed by a shot of a black woman, Teresa Edwards, a four-time Olympic gold medal winner in basketball. The ad then cut to an amateur men's basketball game, with players of all races engaged in intense teamwork. The ball swished through the basket, and the ad zoomed in on a black hand and white palm low-fiving in an acknowledgement of interdependence. A message on the screen read, "We're all on the same team. Team USA." Whereas the ad with the elephant in the diner was designed to make people think, and perhaps make them feel uncomfortable, Weston told me the Team USA ad followed the model of the Obama campaign, to go for the lump in the throat. People wanted to feel good about themselves, and calling them to their better natures did this, just as calling them racists made them angry and defensive. The Team USA ad reinforced the racially inclusive impulses of voters. In another ad, the camera cut seamlessly between two families, one white, one black. In both cases, the families sat on a couch, in identical positions, one child on the mom's lap while a little girl sat on her dad's lap. Both dads read aloud from the children's book The Little Engine That Could. White dad, the very little engine looked up and saw the tears in the doll's eyes. And she thought of the good little boys and girls on the other side of the mountain. Black dad, who would not have any toys or good food unless she helped. And then she said, "I think I can." White dad, "I think I can, I think I can." Black dad, and she hitched herself to the little train, and the little blue engine smiled. White dad, and seemed to say, as she puffed steadily down the mountain. Black dad, "I thought I could, I thought I could." White dad, "I thought I could, I thought I could." Black dad, "I thought I could." It is only a different voice and a different family, but they are sitting exactly the same way and doing exactly the same thing, Weston told me, shortly after he finished supervising the shooting of the ad with the black family. The soundtrack to that is going to be a light piano or a female voice humming Amazing Grace, and the only words that come up on the screen are "We are all God's children." That is calling people to their better angels, to what their faith teaches them. Weston thought the ad was especially effective because research showed that whites were drawn to images of black parents reading to their children, a message counter to the idea of disintegrated black families and disinterested black fathers. When you pair hard work with black, you deactivate the stereotypes that make race so toxic, and when you add paternal responsibility to black dads, you do the same thing, Weston told me. This is why people resonate to Cosby and Obama talking about taking responsibility for their children and father absence being a disaster in the inner cities. You turn down the volume on one of the ways covert racism expresses itself. The voters who participated in testing the ads were men older than 30 and women older than 50 who had not completed college. The results revealed how unconscious attitudes diverged from conscious attitudes. Take the All God's Children ad with the black and white dads reading to their children. Weston shot and tested two versions of the ad, one had the black and white dads, and another featured a white family and two different black families, with one of the black dads darker than the other. In this second version of the ad, all the dads again read from the little engine that could, and the cuts went seamlessly among the families. This ad, with two black families and one white family, scored very high in terms of voters' conscious responses. People really responded, consciously, to the idea of the black dads and the white dad reading the same children's book to their families in different homes. But Weston found that the ad had zero effect on people's unconscious attitudes toward Obama. The ad with the white family and just one black family, featuring the lighter-skinned black dad, generated less positive approval from voters at a conscious level but was far more effective at an unconscious level in changing people's willingness to support Obama. Without their awareness, something about the darker-skinned black dad rubbed voters the wrong way. Their conscious minds may have known we are all God's children, their unconscious minds did not agree. The I Am an American ads with the blue-collar workers speaking directly into the camera about concerns that Obama was an outsider who would harm the interests of white people scored moderately well at the conscious level. But they were highly effective at the level of unconscious attitudes. The ad showing the female worker articulating her doubts and reaching an internal resolution was the most successful of all the ads that Weston and his group created. She said she was born in St. Mary's and had always lived there. She was a lifelong Democrat, and despised the Republican candidates in the 2008 election. Among other things, she thought the government had no business telling women what to do with their bodies. She was fiercely pro-choice. She loved everything about Hillary Clinton. But when Obama won the Democratic nomination, she said she could not bring herself to support him. From what I see, the blacks get entries into college and free loans, Latinos, too, she said. I am opposed to affirmative action. She told me she had been concerned that if Obama won the presidency, the interests of white people would be cast aside. I was worried I would have to go to the back of the bus. She acknowledged that Obama's race was a concern. But then, she told me, she had a talk with her sister, an Obama supporter. The sister convinced her that Obama would not send white people to the back of the bus. She said she was reluctantly coming around to the idea of voting for Obama. I asked her what her sister had said about Obama that had changed her mind. My sister said, "You don't understand, he is white, too. He has a white mom and white grandparents. That had a lot to do with it. As you can see from these conversations, race bias is never completely implicit or completely explicit. Sometimes it lies beneath the surface, you think it is there, but you can't be certain. Other times, you don't have to think at all." Days before the election, the canvasser Roseanne Barker and I had another conversation. She sounded distressed. A large number of signs had appeared overnight in her residential community. The signs consisted of just four words printed on a small sheet of paper: "Vote right, vote white." Elsewhere, she told me, in a repost to Obama's "Change You Can Believe In" slogan, signs said, "Change means, come help another nigger get elected." Barker's voice choked. She said she had raced around the neighborhood taking down the signs. "I didn't think it was so prevalent, but boy, the billboard signs and these laminated pages, it shows that in the rural community I live in, "There is a race problem," she said. "It is my community, the place where I live. More than 100 of these signs had to be taken down. I never dreamed someone would go to that extent. I knew there was prejudice but didn't think it was to that extent." The Chicago O'Hare Hilton Hotel is located within the complex of the busiest airport in the United States. From airport terminals, short walkways put you under the 10-story hotel, which has a facade of black metal and tinted glass. On September 27, 2008, one day after the first 2008 presidential debate between Senators John McCain and Barack Obama, a small group of people from all over the United States flew into Chicago for a secret meeting at the Airport Hilton. Room 2020 in the West Wing of the Hilton had been reserved for the day. On a small plaque affixed outside the room were printed the words "Center for Social Inclusion." The room's interior was occupied by a large rectangular conference table and a dozen black leather chairs. Through the window, you could see shuttles from the Marriott Hotel and National Car Rental Company sweeping by the passenger arrival areas at the airport. From time to time, red and white trains going between terminals rumbled by in opposite directions on an elevated track. The meeting had been organized on short notice. Barely a week and a half had gone by since the group had informally coalesced through emails and conference calls. The people at the meeting were among the country's foremost thinkers on issues related to bias and politics. When Obama became the first African-American candidate to be nominated by a major political party, these experts decided they wanted to apply what scholars had learned about prejudice to combat bias in the election. From Washington, D.C., came Todd Rogers and Chelinda Lake, Democratic Party pollsters and consultants. From Los Angeles came Jerry Kong from the University of California. From New Jersey, Rachel Godsell of Seton Hall Law School. From Atlanta, Drew Weston, a political psychologist and Democratic Party consultant. From Philadelphia, Camille Charles, a sociologist at the University of Pennsylvania. There were several other community activists, political organizers, and academic researchers. Other experts who could not make it to Chicago called in and participated through a speakerphone. The group had been summoned by John Powell, a legal scholar at Ohio State University. If talk about welfare, illegal immigration, and crime were coded ways to talk about race, Powell wanted to come up with ways to deactivate such bias. The first way, the traditional way, was to uncover the bias. You combat subterranean bias, in other words, by bringing it to the surface. The Obama campaign had chosen a different route. Race was rarely to be made explicit, and the campaign never made a fuss about racism. Even in the face of explicit racism, thousands of people openly said that they would never vote for a black man. Obama stayed relentlessly positive. When people hurled racially tinged epithets at Obama at rallies, when some Republican Party leaders openly questioned the biracial candidate's religion, background, and patriotism, when Hillary Clinton publicly declared that Obama's support among working, hard-working Americans, white Americans, is weakening, the campaign responded with the same uplifting messages of unity that Obama had honed since his famous speech at the 2004 Democratic National Convention. Rather than accuse anyone of racial bias, the campaign preferred to call people to their better angels, to remind Americans that they were above racism. Obama's strategy had been successful. He had won the Democratic nomination. But Powell feared there would come a time when the strategy would no longer work. Powell's team had heard that Republicans were planning a major attack in the late fall, drawing on excerpts from Obama's books where he talked about using drugs as a young man and having devoured Marxist and feminist literature. And the speeches of Malcolm X. Powell reached out to the Obama campaign but was met with resistance. "Initially I tried to get the campaign to do it, and they were of the opinion that it wasn't necessary," Powell told me. "My response is, if you are right, great, but what if you are wrong? You should have something ready. If you don't need it, no sweat, but if you want something and don't have it, you are in trouble. They are not taking advantage of the research in the last 30 years. They think talking about race is necessarily divisive. They don't realize people are very conflicted." Mahzarin Banaji called into the Chicago meeting from Harvard. The psychologist had long been a proponent of fighting unconscious bias by dragging it into the open, by making implicit biases visible. But in this situation, she felt Obama was doing the right thing. All politicians, she told me, had to emphasize the bond they had with voters, and it made sense that Obama should stay clear of the subject of race. The bond that a member of a minority group has with most voters cannot be the thing that marks him as a minority. The group discussed different ways in which campaign advertisements have exploited race bias. In the 2006 Senate election in Tennessee, African-American candidate Harold Ford was the target of an ad that played on miscegenation fears. The ad featured a young white woman who claimed to have met Ford at a Playboy party, and ended with her seductively whispering, "Harold, call me." One anti-Obama ad showed the candidate's grinning face morph into the face of a wolf. A conservative group linked Obama with Kwame Kilpatrick, the disgraced black mayor of Detroit, who had recently been ejected from office on criminal charges. As the ad listed the various charges against Kilpatrick, it showed footage of Obama standing with Kilpatrick and praising him. The ad advised voters to learn who Obama's friends were. Kilpatrick's skin is much darker than Obama's, and the ad deliberately darkened Kilpatrick's complexion even further to play on the unconscious biases of white voters against dark-skinned black men, according to sociologist Camille Charles at the University of Pennsylvania. Toward the end of the day, I asked the group around the table how Obama might be vulnerable to unconscious bias. Powell, who wore a beard speckled with gray, said that Obama was not vulnerable in the way African-American leaders usually are. Obama could not be depicted as threatening. But he was vulnerable to suggestions that he was an outsider and foreign. His middle name was Hussein, and he had spent long stretches of his childhood in other countries. It was the "he's not one of us" message that Powell was worried about. "The primary target is the Reagan Democrats," Powell told me. "People who belong to unions, who in Ohio voted for Democratic Governor Ted Strickland. Strickland won by a huge margin. It helped that his opponent was a black Republican. You don't have to convince them that unions are good, or governments have a role, and wouldn't it be great to have health care?" If he lost, Powell concluded about Obama, it would be because people who agreed with Obama on the issues did not want to vote for a black man. It will be because of Democrats. The pollsters, consultants, and psychologists around the table in Chicago decided to devise a series of anti-bias messages and get them out to voters in battleground states. The group wanted to inoculate voters against divisive appeals. They planned to come up with a series of ads to get people to think about the role of race in the election. One would involve shoving an actual elephant into a diner as patrons chewed their food and took nervous glances at the behemoth. As the elephant flapped its ears, a message would say, "Let's talk about the elephant in the room." There was only one time in the 2008 election when the Obama campaign strategy to neutralize the subject of race came completely undone. It was during the Democratic primary, when comments by Obama's pastor, the Reverend Jeremiah Wright of Trinity United Church of Christ in Chicago, surfaced in the national media. Wright had often lashed out at white America in sermons about racial injustice, and Obama's opponents seized on the pastor saying such things as, "Not God bless America. God damn America." The instant Obama found himself linked to Wright's inflammatory comments, his campaign stalled. Reporters later dug up comments made by John C. Hagee, a pastor whom John McCain had embraced, who once said the Holocaust was God's plan to drive Jews to Palestine. And Larry Croon, a pastor of Republican vice presidential nominee Sarah Palin, had said that God would strike the United States of America. On the same day as that first presidential debate, the Washington Post noted that in the fine, new American tradition of presidential campaign pastor disasters, Republican vice presidential nominee Sarah Palin might have won. It made intuitive sense that if Obama got into a heap of trouble because of his pastor's views, the same thing would happen to McCain and Palin. But that did not happen, and the people in room 2020 of the O'Hare Hilton could have told you why. The real issue with Wright was not his militant and overheated comments, but that contact with Wright unconsciously linked Obama to a notion toxic to many white voters, the angry black man who sought to make whites feel guilty about racism. There was no analogous identity archetype that Hagee and Kroon evoked, certainly nothing to rival the deep fears and anxieties that the angry black man conjured. It made sense that the McCain and Palin pastor controversies would sink like stones. I found it interesting that even as the national media wrapped itself into pretzels about Wright's comments, many people of color found Wright utterly unremarkable. Before he parted ways with Wright, Obama himself said he felt his church was not particularly controversial. Wright was certainly inflammatory and given to rhetorical excess, but this partly had to do with the theatricality of sermons in general and the style of the black church in particular. Obama once said Wright is like an old uncle who says things I don't always agree with. But if Wright had a tendency toward overblown rhetoric, most blacks had little problem with the emotional truth of his message. African Americans are 447% more likely than white Americans to be imprisoned and 521% more likely to be murdered. There is a 5-to-1 wealth gap between whites and blacks at birth. Blacks live 5 years fewer on average than whites, and the black infant mortality rate is nearly 1.5 times the white infant mortality rate. Wouldn't it be odd not to be angry? But once Wright's comments surfaced in the national media, and excerpts from his sermons were replayed endlessly on cable television, it was no longer possible for the Obama campaign to sell its "We Are All Americans First" message. The America that Wright described felt like a cruel caricature to many whites. Which version of reality, Obama's opponents asked, did the candidate endorse? Hillary Clinton sat down for a lengthy interview with Bill O'Reilly of Fox News, and agreed with the conservative commentator that Obama had some explaining to do. Where the country had seen in Obama only a quiet, well-spoken Harvard-educated lawyer, the Wright episode raised questions about whether Obama was secretly the kind of militant black activist that many whites abhorred. Obama's first instinct was to let things blow over, but Wright, who could be described as Obama's friend in only the loosest sense of the term, held a televised meeting at the National Press Club in Washington, where he fought back against his critics, argued that they were motivated by racism, and charged that the attacks on him were attacks on the entire black community. Wright addressed his comments to a crowd of supporters, and they gave him a standing ovation. The press conference put Obama in an even more difficult bind. Shortly afterward, Obama renounced his ties with Wright and then did something he almost never did before or after in the 2008 campaign. He explicitly talked about race. In a now famous speech in Philadelphia, Obama presented a picture of race relations very different from that presented by his former pastor. He played conciliator, and explained to white people why black people were often angry, and explained to black people why white people were resentful of being reminded endlessly about the legacy of slavery. The country had come a long way since the days of Jim Crow, Obama reminded his black audience, but the country also had a long way still to go. The speech was psychologically astute, and precisely what a psychologist who studies the hidden brain would have recommended. The researchers Richard P. Ibbick and Joyce Erlinger have shown that a central reason whites and blacks in America have very different impressions about the state of racial progress is that whites unconsciously compare the state of race relations with the past. Compared to the days of slavery, the country has made enormous strides in race relations, and many whites find it incomprehensible that blacks do not regularly acknowledge the progress that has been made. Ibbick and Erlinger found that blacks, on the other hand, unconsciously compare the status quo with an idealized future where discrimination does not exist. For the young black man or woman who suffers subtle forms of discrimination in the workplace, it isn't much consolation to say things were worse 200 years ago. From this perspective, many blacks cannot understand why whites would downplay the reality of their everyday experience. Each side had a point, Obama effectively told his audience, and each side had more in common with the other than either believed. Without overtly looking like he was doing so, Obama also reminded white voters that he was half white. "I can no more disown him than I can my white grandmother," Obama said about his former pastor. The speech was made at the National Constitution Center, and Obama used the occasion to draw the country's attention to the document that bound the nation together. Rather than speak on behalf of any group, Obama spoke on behalf of everyone. The Philadelphia speech was a huge political success, and it revived the Obama campaign. Obama never seriously addressed the subject of race again, and in fact took great pains to avoid the subject altogether. For all the historic significance of an African-American man reaching for the presidency, one of the ironies of the Obama campaign is that it was largely mute when it came to the subject of race. At the Democratic National Convention in Denver, which was held on the 45th anniversary of the famous 1963 March on Washington, with an African-American man on the presidential ticket of a major party for the first time in history, John Powell pointed out to me, with some bitterness, that Obama never mentioned the words race, Martin Luther King, or civil rights in his acceptance speech. The documentary shown about his life, Powell added, was heavy on white people. It emphasized his mother's side of the family, his white side, far more than it did his father's side, even though in his book Dreams from My Father Obama emphasized how important it was for him to find his identity as a black man in order to become a leader. Powell told me, and remember, this was a man who was working 18 to 19 hours a day to get Obama elected, that he found the Philadelphia speech politically brilliant but historically problematic. Rather than talk about the problem of race in America, Obama had talked about the problem of anger in America. Whites were angry with blacks, blacks were angry with whites. If everyone renounced their anger, we would all be better off. But Powell could not abide the idea that black anger and white anger were equivalent and somehow canceled each other out. If blacks were angry about slavery and segregation, discrimination, and a lack of opportunities, whites were angry because they felt undeserving blacks were taking advantage of the system. Dr. King, in his most important speeches, talked about the importance of righteous indignation, Powell told me. Obama understands that he is playing to a white audience. If he can be Tiger Woods and a non-threatening black, he thinks he can get the support of white people. Two undercurrents of discomfort ran beneath the table at the secret Chicago meeting. One had to do with the conflicting challenges of fighting bias and fighting to win an election. The people around the table knew that if they were against bias, they also had to be against the ageism and sexism that prompted voters to feel McCain was too old and that Sarah Palin was yet another incompetent woman. By the end of the meeting, Powell said the goal was less about getting Obama elected and more about removing bias from the equation. As long as voters did not reject a candidate because of bias, it was perfectly legitimate to vote for or against anyone. But there was another undercurrent that ran still deeper. When you found unconscious bias, there were two things you could do about it. You could fight it at an implicit level, as the Obama campaign was doing. Without ever making a fuss about racism, you could project counter-stereotypical messages that radiated calm and reassurance. The other approach was explicit. You called out voters who agreed with your candidate on the issues but were reluctant to vote for him because of racism. This would be the Martin Luther King, Jr., way, the path of righteous indignation. The trouble was, calling people out on racism made them defensive. Even if you won the argument, you could lose their vote. The Obama approach was much more astute politically, but there was something disturbing about it. If the only way for a black politician to be acceptable to whites was to project an image of a non-threatening black man, the exception to the rule, wasn't that implicitly an endorsement of the stereotype? These concerns would be amplified as the group designed a series of ads and tested them among a large number of undecided white voters in battleground states. Chalinda Lake ran the ads by 500 men and 500 women with blue-collar backgrounds, the people who told white pollsters one thing and black pollsters something else. Lake asked the voters what they made of each ad and how it made them feel. The psychologist Drew Weston measured how the ads changed unconscious attitudes toward Obama. The Elephant in the Room ad was an example of how bias might be combated explicitly. Another ad targeted the hidden brain. It involved a blue-collar worker speaking directly into the camera. One version featured a man, another a woman. The speaker articulated many of the concerns about Obama that were being circulated in white working-class communities, that Obama would give preference to black people, and that he was an unpatriotic outsider. The idea, said Weston, was to openly acknowledge what people were feeling. But rather than dismiss such concerns as racist or wrong, as the union leader Richard Trumka had done with his old friend in Namakalan, Pennsylvania, the ad gave people an alternative way to think about their feelings. This was the text of the ad featuring a 50-ish white woman. The woman was identified as Sue Burton of Zanesville, Ohio. A lot of people aren't quite sure about Barack Obama. He seems steady. He talks about things that matter to me, the price of gas and groceries, and health care we can count on. But then sometimes I get that feeling, you know, uneasy. I'm not really sure who he is. Does he really love his country? Maybe if he gets elected, he's going to put the interests of black people above the interests of the rest of us. You know, I was talking with my mom about it. She and Dad had the same questions about President Kennedy before he was elected. They had that same feeling. Uneasy. Maybe he'd put his Catholic faith before his country. I'm not prejudiced. I just want to know that he shares my values and cares about people like me. And I think he does. I think he loves his two little girls just like I love mine. I think he loves our country just like I do. It hasn't been easy for me. But I'm going to give him a chance. I am an American, and so is he. The conventional way to counter an untruth is to confront it. Indeed, if you subscribe to the notion that people's conscious minds are all that matter, this is what you should do. Good information ought to drive bad information out of circulation. It's only when you think about politics with the hidden brain in mind that you understand why innumerable fact-checking websites and media articles ahead of the 2008 presidential election did little to prevent millions of Americans from believing blatant falsehoods about Obama. The "I am an American" ad took a different tack. It set aside the conscious mind altogether and focused entirely on the hidden brain. Rather than tell people that the allegations against Obama were false, the ad took the point of view of people who felt uneasy. It was an old lesson from therapy textbooks: regardless of whether feelings were justified, they were real. You cannot eliminate feelings by denying their validity; indeed, denying them usually strengthened them. The "I am an American" ad did not present refutations to the woman's beliefs or try to show that her feelings were unjustified or wrong. Rather, it was the woman herself who made the emotional decision to override her fears. She wasn't being corrected. She was being courageous. The message tested well in focus groups, but some funders, Weston told me, were uncomfortable about a message that did not explicitly refute untrue insinuations about Obama. The notion of setting aside the conscious mind and focusing only on the hidden brain can be difficult to swallow. But if you refute it, it has a different meaning, Weston said. My conscious concern about the refutation is it sounds contrived. This does not sound like a person who has struggled with this. It sounds like an Obama campaign worker. The experts tested a number of other approaches. One ad called Team USA showed a girls' soccer match in progress with the soundtrack of America the Beautiful in the background. A series of adorable black and white children played together, intensely focused on the game, with smiles and camaraderie. It then showed a close-up shot of Joe Jacoby, a white Olympic gold medal winner in white water canoeing, followed by a shot of a black woman, Teresa Edwards, a four-time Olympic gold medal winner in basketball. The ad then cut to an amateur men's basketball game, with players of all races engaged in intense teamwork. The ball swished through the basket, and the ad zoomed in on a black hand and white palm low-fiving in an acknowledgement of interdependence. A message on the screen read, "We're all on the same team. Team USA." Whereas the ad with the elephant in the diner was designed to make people think, and perhaps make them feel uncomfortable, Weston told me the Team USA ad followed the model of the Obama campaign, to go for the lump in the throat. People wanted to feel good about themselves, and calling them to their better natures did this, just as calling them racists made them angry and defensive. The Team USA ad reinforced the racially inclusive impulses of voters. In another ad, the camera cut seamlessly between two families, one white, one black. In both cases, the families sat on a couch, in identical positions, one child on the mom's lap while a little girl sat on her dad's lap. Both dads read aloud from the children's book The Little Engine That Could. White Dad, the very little engine looked up and saw the tears in the doll's eyes. And she thought of the good little boys and girls on the other side of the mountain. Black Dad, who would not have any toys or good food unless she helped. And then she said, I think I can. White Dad, I think I can, I think I can. Black Dad, and she hitched herself to the little train, and the little blue engine smiled. White Dad, and seemed to say, as she puffed steadily down the mountain. Black Dad, I thought I could, I thought I could. White Dad, I thought I could, I thought I could. Black Dad, I thought I could. It is only a different voice and a different family, but they are sitting exactly the same way and doing exactly the same thing, Weston told me, shortly after he finished supervising the shooting of the ad with the Black family. The soundtrack to that is going to be a light piano or a female voice humming Amazing Grace, and the only words that come up on the screen are "We are all God's children." That is calling people to their better angels, to what their faith teaches them. Weston thought the ad was especially effective because research showed that whites were drawn to images of Black parents reading to their children, a message counter to the idea of disintegrated Black families and disinterested Black fathers. When you pair hard work with Black, you deactivate the stereotypes that make race so toxic, and when you add paternal responsibility to Black dads, you do the same thing, Weston told me. This is why people resonate to Cosby and Obama talking about taking responsibility for their children and father absence being a disaster in the inner cities. You turn down the volume on one of the ways covert racism expresses itself. The voters who participated in testing the ads were men older than 30 and women older than 50 who had not completed college. The results revealed how unconscious attitudes diverged from conscious attitudes. Take the All God's Children ad with the Black and white dads reading to their children. Weston shot and tested two versions of the ad, one had the Black and white dads, and another featured a white family and two different Black families, with one of the Black dads darker than the other. In this second version of the ad, all the dads again read from the little engine that could, and the cuts went seamlessly among the families. This ad, with two Black families and one white family, scored very high in terms of voters' conscious responses. People really responded, consciously, to the idea of the Black dads and the white dad reading the same children's book to their families in different homes. But Weston found that the ad had zero effect on people's unconscious attitudes toward Obama. The ad with the white family and just one Black family, featuring the lighter-skinned Black dad, generated less positive approval from voters at a conscious level but was far more effective at an unconscious level in changing people's willingness to support Obama. Without their awareness, something about the darker-skinned Black dad rubbed voters the wrong way. Their conscious minds may have known we are all God's children, their unconscious minds did not agree. The "I am an American" ads with the blue-collar workers speaking directly into the camera about concerns that Obama was an outsider who would harm the interests of white people scored moderately well at the conscious level. But they were highly effective at the level of unconscious attitudes. The ad showing the female worker articulating her doubts and reaching an internal resolution was the most successful of all the ads that Weston and his group created. Effectively, the group that met at the Chicago Hilton had come up with a series of tools. To be sure, the tools were crude, but they were the first real attempt made in the heat of a political campaign to turn down the volume on racial bias. As it turned out, none of the ads were aired before the 2008 election because the financial meltdown in the weeks before the election sent potential funders scurrying for cover. Powell's team also found that many of the attack ads planned against Obama were never aired for the same reason. But the research showed that in order to combat conscious and explicit bias, people who shout racist things at rallies and put up "Vote Right, Vote White" signs, ads of children playing together on a team, or Black and white families doing identical things, are effective. To combat outright hatred, you want to call people to their better angels, and hope the lump in their throats can overcome the bile in their hearts. But when it comes to unconscious bias, the gray monster lurking beneath the surface in a large number of voters, you need different tools. The "I am an American" ad acknowledged the way many voters felt about Obama. Without telling them that they were wrong, it suggested an alternative route to channel their feelings. "We are going back to the future to Freud," Weston told me. "There really is this dissociation he spoke about between the conscious and the unconscious, but we now have ways of measuring it. How do you detoxify race in elections so people cannot run the Call Me, Harold ad or the Quame Kilpatrick ad or the Willie Horton ad? If you are vulnerable to such attacks, you have to measure both conscious and unconscious attitudes and develop strategies that address both." I found the ads fascinating, but also disturbing, in that they sometimes placed what made political sense at odds with what made ethical sense. "Which version of the All God's Children ad would you have chosen if you were a political consultant?" "You wouldn't have chosen the ad showing the darker-skinned black dad, because Weston's data demonstrated that it worked less well at persuading white voters than the ad that showed only the lighter-skinned black dad. In order to be politically effective, to get voters to support your candidate, you had to choose the ad that went along with people's unconscious biases against darker-skinned black men. The same went for the I Am an American ad. When people spread racist lies about a black candidate, the obvious response was righteous indignation, but the more effective response was apparently to approach the problem sideways, to tell voters that the way they felt was understandable, but to ask them to take a chance on the candidate. Racist beliefs, in other words, were best left unchallenged if you wanted to persuade someone to vote for your candidate. I started to understand why Obama's approach had succeeded where so many other black politicians had failed, his campaign's conscious decision not to cry foul, not to voice the righteous indignation to which he was surely entitled, was the only way he could win. I asked Jalinda Lake about this after the election. She acknowledged that there was a tension between fighting stereotypes and trying to get a candidate elected. But she pointed out that if getting Obama into the White House involved making some compromises, it was also the case that Obama's election promised to reduce racism in the United States as nothing else could. The hidden brain learns through blind repetition, and Obama's election meant the country and the world would spend the next several years being bombarded with counter-stereotypical messages about a very smart, articulate, and charismatic black man, who happened to be the most powerful person on the planet. Having worked for a number of African-American candidates, Lake said, "I don't care if I get someone elected by appealing to exceptionalism, the idea that that particular black candidate was the exception to the rule, an approach that could reinforce stereotypes. I would like to end racism, but I first want to get Barack Obama elected." Lake told me that David Axelrod, the political mastermind behind the Obama campaign, had helped a number of African-American candidates get elected by relentlessly not focusing on trying to change people's underlying views about race and gender. When getting Carol Moseley Braun elected to the Senate, for example, pollsters once found that having Braun stand up and speak directly into the camera for an ad prompted voters to feel she was in their face, in a way they did not feel when a white man delivered exactly the same lines. It was clearly sexist and racist, and the path of righteous indignation might have said, "The hell with such biases, have Braun speak directly into the camera." But Axelrod, whose job it was to get Braun elected, suggested she sit behind a table and speak her lines. Voters immediately found the message more acceptable. I don't know how to resolve the imperative of righteous indignation with the imperative to get your candidate elected. If the techniques of political consultants are sometimes icky, it should also be said that righteous indignation never got a black man elected president. It was Axelrod and Obama who found a way to make King's dream come true, by sidestepping controversy and turning down the temperature on race. Unfairness seems written into the DNA of politics, because voters consciously and unconsciously care about a host of factors that candidates cannot control. Political consultants will always try to find ways to win with the cards they are dealt, and that can mean exploiting both legitimate strengths and unfair advantages. Obama was clearly a gifted candidate. His calm, even tempered style was a matter of natural inclination, and his adoration of his daughters was obviously sincere. Being a calm person does not automatically mean someone will make a good president, but the trait served Obama well in that a hot-tempered nature might have evoked the dreaded trope of the angry black man. Obama's visible love for his children helped disable unconscious stereotypes that link black men with disinterested fatherhood. Obama also happened to be biracial, and he used his links to whiteness to his advantage. Barack Obama had light-colored skin, and that made a big difference, Drew Weston said quietly after the election, during a conference call that brought everyone from the Chicago meeting up to speed on what the research had found. Had he looked like Kwame Kilpatrick, it is not at all clear to me that he could have made it. This was Chapter 9, thank you for listening. Subscribe for listening more amazing audiobooks like this.